pressure, or first thought to say, no, of course it's easier to say your sins are forgiven. But to heal him from paralysis, it's a miracle. It's difficult. But in reality, actually, it is easier for the Lord Jesus Christ to say to the paralytic man, your sins arise, take up your bed and walk. You know what? Because to say these words did not cost God anything. Nothing. A word from his holy mouth, by the power of his divinity, he can heal this paralytic man. But to tell him your sins are forgiven cost the Lord what? To empty himself, to take the form of man, to be born among us as poor, to live among us where he did not find a place to rest his head. And at the end, he suffered, you know, shedding of his blood with all the torture of crucifixion. That's why St. Peter tells us, you are precious with price. When Abuna says to you, may the Lord absolve you, may the Lord forgive you, you should know that this word is very, very precious. You are not precious with silver or with gold or precious stones. You were precious by the blood of the Lamb of God, by the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why Nathan said to David, the Lord transfer your sin. Any sin I confess it, it's transferred from me and is placed on the Lamb of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. Besides, if the Lord healed this paralytic man, he may live 30, 40, 50 years and then he will die. And if his sins are not forgiven, he will not be saved. But if the Lord did not heal him, but forgive his sin, yes, he may live 30, 40, 50 years as a paralytic man, but at the end, actually, he would enjoy the eternal life with the Lord Jesus Christ and in heaven. That's why the Lord gave him the more precious gift. So David here realizes the importance of forgiveness. That's why he started the psalm by saying, blessed mean how happy he is. Happy is he. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven. Why? Why might I am happy when my transgression is forgiven? He mentioned many reasons. Number one, when we confess our sins, God will cover these sins for us. When we confess our sins, God will cover it. God will not reveal it. He will forget it. That's why he said, whose sins is covered. If we condemn ourselves, God will not condemn us. But if we refuse to condemn ourselves, then our sins will be revealed to everybody. If not revealed here on earth, it will be revealed in the last day. So the first blessing, when we confess our sins, that our sins will be covered. Number two, the Lord will not hold me accountable, which means I will have peace with God. That's why in verse 2 he said, blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity. So number one, my sins will be covered. Number two, I will have peace with God. Number three, actually, I will have peace with myself. So no more groaning. No more groaning. I will have peace with myself because I will be free from the shame, the guilt, and the fear. And of course, number four is the forgiveness. I will be forgiven. I will be forgiven, as he said, you forgive the iniquity of my sins. So he mentioned so far four blessings when we confess our sins. Forgiveness, peace with God, peace with oneself, and my sins will be covered. If confession is to God, so any communication with God, we call it what? Prayer. So in the reality, confession is prayer. In confession, I am praying to God. When I say, I have sinned against you, God, by doing so and so and so and so, I'm praying. That's why in verse 6, he said, for this cause, everyone who is godly shall pray to you in the time when you may be found. For this cause, which cause? For the peace with God, for the peace with oneself, for the forgiveness of sins, for the covering of my sins, for all these reasons, everyone who is godly shall pray, shall confess, shall acknowledge his sins to you in a time when you may be found. But God is found all time. God, we can find him in any time, in any place. So what David meant here when he said, in a time when you may be found. Do you remember the parable of the 10 virgins? The 5 wise and the 5 foolish. The 5 foolish, actually, they were not ready. They did not repent. They did not confess their sins. That's why their lamps has no oil, has no grace of the Holy Spirit. So when the bridegroom came, they were not ready. And the door was shut. Then when they came and knocked on the door, the Lord told them, depart from me, I do not know you. They could not find God. So when David said, in a time when you may be found, it's not about God, it's about me. Before it is too late, before I die and depart from this world, and it is too late to find God. That's why every godly person, in order to enjoy the forgiveness, the covering of sin, peace with God, peace with oneself, every godly person will confess to you, will acknowledge his sins, will pray to you before it is too late, before the door is shut, before I cannot find you. Then, in the second half of verse 6, David add a fifth blessing. He said, surely in a flood of great waters they shall not come near him. So there is here protection. When there is a flood of great water, like tsunami or hurricane, that the flood of great water will not come near the person who confesses his sins to God. God will protect him. Of course, we take this in a spiritual meaning. Even during the time of hardships, the time of difficulties in our life, God will deliver me. God will protect me. The flood of the temptation, the flood of the temptation of the world will not come near to me. God will protect me. When the flood of this passing world will try to tempt me, to drown me in the pleasures of the world, but God will protect me. That's why he said, you are my highly praised. You shall preserve me from trouble. You shall surround me with songs of deliverance. David is saying, when there is a trouble, when there is hardship, I will hide in you. You are my refuge. You are my hiding place. Because you will preserve me from trouble. Not only that, but you will surround me with songs of deliverance. So you will protect me and preserve me from trouble. But even if the trouble approaches me, like the three young men in the furnace of fire, or Daniel in the lion's den, you will deliver me. So here in another blessing, beside the blessing that you mentioned, the blessing of deliverance. But I want to focus a little bit on the word, you are my hiding place. Usually, any criminal person will try to run away or escape from the civil authority. Because if I go to the civil authority and I plead guilty and I say I'm guilty, then I will be condemned. If you go to the judge and tell him I am guilty, he will condemn me. But with God, actually, it works the opposite. When we go to God and I say I am guilty, my sins will be dismissed. The whole case will be dropped. Because Jesus Christ is not only my judge, but he is also my Lord. I want you to turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 8. St. Paul explained to us how Jesus is not only my judge, but also my lawyer. In the world, you cannot be a judge and a lawyer at the same time. You cannot. But in verse 33, Romans 8, 33, St. Paul is saying, who shall bring a charge against God's elect? As if he's saying, who dares to bring a charge against God's elect? Can Satan dare, because Satan here is taking the role of the prosecutor, can Satan dare to bring a charge against God's elect? Then he answers, of course not. Why? Because it is God who justifies. It's God who will dismiss the charges to justify us. Then he's asking, who is the judge? Who is he who condemns? It's Christ. Christ is the judge. But our judge did what? Because he is a just judge, but also a merciful judge. So it is Christ who died. And furthermore, it is also written, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us, is defending me. He is my lawyer now. He's my attorney. He's defending me with his blood. So I can imagine the scene before the divine court in the last day. Satan will come and bring a charge against me and says to Christ the judge, he says, you know that so-and-so committed such sin, committed murder, committed adultery, committed judging, gossiping, lying, anything. So Christ the judge, he will say, yes, I know he committed such sin. But also, he came and confessed his sins. And he puts these sins on my shoulder. And I died, and I shed my blood for him. Now I covered his sins with my blood. That's my righteousness. He is righteous because I covered him with my blood. So all the charges against him are dropped. There is no case. You cannot bring a charge against my son or my daughter, because they put the sin on my shoulder when they repented and they confessed. That's why in the book of Revelation, when John saw people walking in white garments, He asked, who are they? And the answer was not those who are never sinned. No. The answer was those who washed their clothes in the blood of the Lamb. Every time I confess my sins and I repent and I take communion, I wash my sins completely in the blood of the Lamb. And now I'm justified. That's why when I commit a crime, I don't run away from the judge, but I run to the judge, because he will dismiss the charges. That's why he said, you are my hiding place. You are my hiding place. In the Agbaya, in the midnight hour, in the second watch, in the second litany of the second watch of the midnight hour, what did we say? We say, when I realize my many wicked deeds and the thought of the judgment comes to my heart and the tremble takes hold of me, what should I do? When I remember all my wicked deeds and when I remember the awesome judgment and when I am terrified, tremble takes hold of me, what should I do? I run to you. Not I run from you, I escape to you. I run to you, God, love of mankind. Because I know when I run to you, when I come to you, you will dismiss my charges. That's why he said to him, you are my hiding place. You are my hiding place. You preserve me from trouble. And you will deliver me. You shall surround me with songs of deliverance. So when we repent and confess our sins, then our sins will be forgiven. We will have peace with God. We'll have peace with ourselves. Our sins will be covered. We will enjoy protection from God. And also we will enjoy deliverance. Six blessings so far. Then verse 8, God now took the pen from David and God wrote verse 8 and 9. So verse 8 and 9, it is God who speaks. God said, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with my heart. Many times, we say, I know I am wrong, but I do not have to repent. I do not give me practical steps. What should I do? How can I change my life? How can I get rid of these sins? Especially the sins that are so dear to me. How can I repent and transform my life? But here is the answer. Don't worry. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. Then I love the verse, I will guide you with my heart. You know, before the GPS, when we get direction, you give me direction, tell me take this highway and then take this exit, then make left, then second signal you make right, until you reach the address. And usually, when you have direction like this, sometimes you get lost. If you miss the exit or if you make the traffic light, you get lost. But now with the GPS, even if you get lost, the GPS will do what? Will correct the way. Will make you know, make a U-turn. Here is D2. As if the GPS is watching you. As if his eyes is upon you. And when you do a mistake, then actually he will redirect you. God is saying the same. I will guide you with my arm. So I'm not going to give you a direction and tell you, here is the way of righteousness. Go and walk in the way of righteousness. No. I will guide you with my eye. I will watch every step. And don't worry, even if you miss the things, if you did a mistake, I'm guiding you with my eye. So I tell you, stop, make a U-turn. That's wrong. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. The Holy Spirit, when He comes, He will teach you and will remind you with everything that I have said to you. That's why in Psalm 73, Asaph said, you held my right hand. So God, like a father, holding my right hand and walking me step by step. That's what we say in the Divine Liturgy. Chimoy Chagon Echonetik Metkul. Chimoy means, as translated in English, lead me throughout the way into your kingdom. Throughout the way means what? Step by step, lead me. Don't give me direction and leave me alone. No, no. You need to walk with me, guide me, hold my hand, and lead me step by step throughout the way into your kingdom. This is how God guides us. Remember the Old Testament? A pillar of light was walking in front of Moses and the children of Israel in the wilderness of Sinai. Step by step, with the cloud and with the light, God guides them step by step till they enter the promised land. So, now I have seven blessings, by the way. Peace with God, peace with oneself, forgiveness of sins, covering to my sins, protection, deliverance, and instruction. God will instruct me, will teach me, will guide me with His own eye, step by step. The verse 9 is a beautiful verse. God is saying to us, don't be like the horse or like the mule, which have no understanding, which must be harnessed with bit and bridle, else they will not come near you. God here, like a shepherd, has a big farm. And this farm has many sheep, many oxen, many lambs, horses, mules. And there is one stubborn and foolish horse or mule that refuses to follow the instruction and the guidance of the shepherd. Because I said foolish, have no understanding. So the shepherd tells him, come to the farm, come inside the sheepfold to be protected. I want to protect you, I want to deliver you. But in his stubbornness and in his foolishness, he refuses to follow the shepherd. So the shepherd, in order to protect this horse, so he will harness the horse with bit and bridle. In order to bring him inside the farm. So God is saying, don't act like this stubborn or foolish horse or mule. Don't be like the horse or like the mule which have no understanding. The horse or mule, in order to control them, you need to harness them with bit and bridle. But when you come freely to me, when you come and confess your sins freely to me, without, you know, harnessing you with bit and bridle, then the bit and bridle will not come near you. Else the bit and bridle will not come near you. As if God is telling us, don't force me to use bit and bridle to break you. Like Samson. Samson was actually living a very sinful life. And God wanted to deliver him. And God waited and waited for Samson to come to come by his own free will. But he rejected. He was like this horse or mule which had no understanding. So God actually used the bit and brittle by delivering him into the hand of the Philistines. They blocked out his eyes. They bound him with chains, fetters of iron. And they made him cry. And here only Samson repented and returned back to God. And St. Paul mentioned him among the heroes of faith in Hebrews chapter 11. God doesn't want to use the bit and brittle with us. But sometimes we force God to put us through hardships, to put us through discipline in order for us to repent. And many people even, with this hardship, they continue in their stubbornness and they don't repent. Like Judas. Judas, after delivering the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord gave him so many warnings. And this guilt that he felt, like David said, my vitality was turned into the drought of summer. Actually, Judas felt this guilt and shame in his heart so much. But instead of turning back to God, actually he went and killed himself. So this guilt and sorrow and depression actually was bit and brittle to bring Judas. But Judas actually continued to be stubborn, continued to be foolish, and did not return back to God. But Peter, when he felt this depression of sorrow, when he wept bitterly, he used this to return back to God. So, verse 3, like when David said, when I kept silent, my bones grew old through my groaning all the day long, for day and night your hand was heavy upon me. Why God's hand was heavy upon him? That's the bit of brittle. To bring David back to confession, to bring David back to repentance. So David is saying, I was that horse for you that refused to repent. But the heavy hand of God, the discipline of God, made me repent, either when he numbered the people or when he sent with the wife of So either in the sin of adultery or either in when he numbered the people. So God here in verse 9, he's telling us, don't be like the horse or like the mule, which have no understanding, which must be harnessed with bit and bridle. Else, if you come freely, repenting and confessing your sins, then the bit and bridle will not come near to you. So are we going, especially during this time of fasting, are we going to repent and to confess freely with our own free will, or we are going to wait until God uses bit and bridle and we suffer and our vitality will turn into the drought of summer in order to go and confess our sins? Then verse 10, many sorrows shall be to the wicked. Why? Why many sorrows? By the way, this time is not time of condemnation. It's time of salvation. The Lord said, I did not come to condemn the world, but to save the world. And we say it in every divine liturgy. And he appointed a day for recompense in which we will appear to judge the world in righteousness and give each one according to his deeds. So this time is not time of condemnation. So what is the purpose of sorrows? The sorrows here are the bitter brittle, are the heavy hand of God. And God will use his sorrow to the wicked to lead them to repentance. Many sorrow shall be to the wicked. In order to repent, in order to come to me, in order to confess their sins. But he who trusts in the Lord, mercy shall surround him. He trusts in the Lord. Maybe somebody would say, if I go to God and say I'm guilty, maybe God actually condemn me. He will tell me I'm guilty. So how should I know if I confess to God, God will forgive me and will dismiss the charges against me? Here is the trust. Here is the confidence in the promises of God. Here we need to believe his promises. As St. John said, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive our sins. So let us have this trust. And when we trust God, what will happen? The mercy of God will surround you. The mercies of the Lord will surround you. So another blessing. Those who confess their sins, they will enjoy the mercies of God. So I will have forgiveness. Peace with God. Peace with myself. My sins will be covered. Then I will enjoy protection. I will enjoy deliverance. I will enjoy instruction from God, and also mercy will surround me. And the last blessing in verse 11. Be glad in the Lord, and rejoice, you righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. So he repeated three times the word glad or joy. Be glad in the Lord, rejoice, you righteous, shout for joy, all you upright in heart. This righteousness is the righteousness. What are you inspired of joy? Can you imagine? If you committed a crime, and the punishment of this crime is death penalty, and there is no way to, because all the evidences are against you, you committed such a crime, and then on the day of the court, you went to the court, and the death penalty is written against you. Then the judge will tell you, we received today a presidential pardon for you. And now you are released. The case is dismissed. Definitely will be happy. Definitely will be joyful. So the wages of sin is death. So every time when we confess our sins, after, besides we are relieved from the burden of guilt and shame and fear. Besides this, actually, we are full of joy. Full of joy because the death penalty is dropped. I will enjoy eternal life. So, confessing my sins will lead to joy. Joy leads to what? Thanksgiving. I will go and give thanks to God for dismissing my sin, dismissing the charges against me. And when actually I thank God, how can I thank God? In prayer. So I will stand before God. And when I stand before God, this actually, just being in the presence of God will bring joy to my heart. During the Holy Great Fast, we chant in the state of Hallelujah for baby, Hallelujah. Which means I enter into the house of God before the altar of God, which brings joy to my heart. The Lord said, until now you cannot ask anything in my name. Ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. So I want you to imagine confession and prayer leads to joy. Joy leads to what? Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving leads to what? To prayer. Prayer is what? To joy. Joy is what? To thanksgiving. Thanksgiving prayer. So that's what I say, a spiral of joy. So I will end up doing what? Praying without ceasing. Giving thanks in everything. and rejoicing in the Lord always. And by the way, these are the three commandments that God asked us to do all the time, as we read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Rejoice in the Lord always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in everything. And because these three meet each other, I told you confession is prayer. So prayer is thanking to joy. Joy means thanksgiving. Thanksgiving means to prayer. Prayer, joy, joy, and so on. That's a spiral of joy. So now actually, when we confess our sins, there are nine blessings. Nine blessings. I have peace with God. I have peace with myself. My sins will be forgiven. My sins will be covered. Protection. Deliverance. Instruction. Mercy will surround me. I will enjoy the joy of the Lord. I will rejoice in the Lord. I want to conclude by asking two questions. The first question, what are the prerequisites of forgiveness? What are the prerequisites of forgiveness? The second question, why God need some prerequisites for forgiveness? Why just doesn't forgive my sins? He already died on the cross for all the sins of all the people in all ages. So if he already paid the price of sin for all of us, so let him forgive us, whether we confessed or we did not confess, whether we repented or we did not repent, because the blood of Jesus is enough to justify the whole world. So why he need prerequisites for forgiveness? And usually, when we speak about forgiveness, we say forgiveness is unconditional. So why, when it comes to God, it is conditional? If we say we should forgive one another unconditionally, why with God it's different? Why there is a condition? Why God made some conditions for forgiveness? These are the two questions I'd like to answer before we conclude. There are two prerequisites for forgiveness. The first one, I said it in the lecture several times, to confess your sins. Confess your sins. The second one, verse 2, I skipped the second half of verse 2, but now I'm going to the second half of the verse 2. He said, blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. What does it mean, in whose spirit there is no deceit? God is saying, when you come and confess your sins, don't try to deceive. Because God cannot be deceived. You can deceive yourself, you can deceive your friends, you can deceive your woman, you can deceive your family, but you cannot deceive God. So when we confess our sins, we should go with an undeceiving spirit. Let me give you an example of what I mean by undeceiving spirit. Sometimes I go and confess my sins, but still I have plans for sin. I'm not willing to repent. I'm just going and confessing these sins, thinking that just saying the sins, I will be forgiven, then I will go and commit these sins over and over, and after 3 weeks I come to Abuna and confess my sins again, and they go committing these sins again and come to Abuna. That's deception. You cannot deceive God. When you come to God in confession, you should come with a repentant heart. A heart that is determined to fight until bloodshed against sin. But if I'm going just as a habit or as a routine to calm my conscience, but again, I have plans for sin, or I'm not willing to quit and to repent, then actually that's deception. Deception also when I hide some sins. I'm not honest in my confession. You can deceive a woman, but maybe you cannot deceive God, but for sure you cannot deceive God. Or sometimes when you twist words, so as if you confess your sins, but in reality, you said a very, very vague word, very vague word that does not reflect your accountability or your responsibility of sin. You don't own the problem. Just you say some vague words. This is deception. I remember one of the fathers told me that there is a youth, Abuna for a long time was encouraging him to come and confess, but he was resisting. And finally, he came and he confessed his sins. So Abuna was very, very joyful. Finally, this youth came and confessed. And at the end of the confession, so this youth said to Abuna, Abuna, I'm going to Egypt in order to find a bride, so can you give me a shadat khilou mana? So he went to Abuna for confession, actually he did this shahada, not because he repented. So that's another sort of deception. You are deceiving God, you are not deceiving anybody else. So confession, in order to be forgiven, you need to go and confess your sins honestly and with a repentant heart. That's why before confession, you need to own your problem. You need to correct the consequences of the problem, as the king said. You need to develop godly sorrow, which leads to repentance, as St. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 7. You need to determine from your heart to resist until bloodshed against sin. You need to have hope and confidence and trust in the forgiveness of God. Then you go and confess your sins. So there are 5 steps before going to Abuna. To own the problem. Own the problem means be responsible. Be accountable. Don't find excuses. Don't blame others. And correct the consequences of your sins. Develop the godly sorrow. And determine, promise God that you will resist until bloodshed against sin. Having confidence in the forgiveness of God. So these are the 2 prerequisites for forgiveness. Confession and no deceit. So last question, why God just doesn't forgive us our sins? Because the ultimate goal of God is not to forgive our sins. There is good beyond it. God wants to be reconciled. God wants to be united with us. Let me, in order to explain this, let me give you an analogy. If there is a couple, one spouse is very abusive and the second is so forgiving. So this person, the abusive spouse, continue to insult and abuse the other spouse. And this spouse always forgive. Do you think this would be a healthy relationship? Of course not. And actually, this forgiveness is not actually forgiveness. It's a license for more abuse, license for more sin. That's why in order to reconcile this couple, we need to say to this person, the abusive spouse, you need to own your problem. You need to go and apologize and say, I'm sorry. I have no excuse. I will stop this abuse. Then actually, when this spouse will forgive, they can be reconciled. God doesn't want to have an abusive relationship with us in which we are the abusive partner and God is a forgiving partner. Yes, God is willing to forgive us, but we will never have reconciliation because His forgiveness will be license to sin for us, as if God is giving me license. Do whatever you want to do, I will forgive you. Then I will continue to be the abusive partner, and God will continue to be the forgiving partner. But we will never be united because there is no fellowship between light and darkness. There is no fellowship between holiness and iniquities. I cannot be one with God. And if I cannot be one with God, then I cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Because how can we inherit the kingdom of God? When I am one with Christ, then I in Christ, I mean Son of God. Through this marriage with Christ, we will be children to God the Father. And as St. Paul said in Romans chapter 8, if we are children, we are heirs. But if I am not one with Christ, I cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. I will never get this inheritance because I'm not a children. I'm not among his children. So if the ultimate goal of God is to forgive us, he already forgave us. When he died on the cross and he said, Father, forgive them, he already forgave us. But God put two prerequisites to forgive our, to confess our sins and to go to him without deceit, because the ultimate goal is the reconciliation, to be one. I want them to be one with me as I am one with you, Father, as he said in John chapter 17. And we need to understand this very well. Maybe for us, all what we care is to be forgiven, but no. What we care about should be to be one with Christ, to be reconciled with Christ. That's why God made some conditions, because with these conditions, he can be united with us. He can be reconciled with us. Without these conditions, we cannot be reconciled. I hope that this song sheds some light on the importance of repentance and confession. I know for some of us, confession is like a burden, and we are reluctant to go and confess our sins. But I hope that enjoying these nine blessings of confession, knowing that God wants to be reconciled with us, we take this time of the great fast to repent, to confess our sins, then indeed we will hear this blessing. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sins is covered. Glory to God.